Good evening, friends, and welcome to this interactive lecture meeting on crowdfunding, newcomers, IPO, and SME listing. Dignitaries on the dais, Mr. Neeraj Kulashrestha, our chairman of our committee, Mr. Kanubhai Ajay ji, also from the BSE, Mahavir, who is also the second speaker, and Chetan, Vice President. I welcome all of you and thank you for making it on a working day. My name is Raman Jokhakar and I serve as an honorary president of Bombay Chartered Accountants Society. And this is one of the features that we have in our calendar. Every twice a month, regularly we organize lecture meetings. Sometimes it's done jointly, like this one with the Bombay Stock Exchange, on various topics. And this particular topic is obviously of a different kind than the usual audit, tax, and you know, all those complicated ones. So I'm very happy to see you all here, and I'll request all our speakers and dignitaries to light the lamp and start this session. So I request all of you to please join me here. About the society, for those who don't know, we are half the age as the BSE, which is, you know, more than 140 years. The society was started by, you know, a bunch of professionals, chartered accountants, way back in 1949, and we do focus on mainly educational events, which are around the areas which the professionals in practice as well as those in industry need to keep themselves updated on. So we do almost 130,000 hours of events, off-site events, seminars, workshops, lecture meetings like this one. We do publications and so on. So we are very proud to have this program together with BSE, and for that we are very grateful to both Ajay ji as well as Neeraj ji to arrange this event in this premises. Friends, you already know, I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but you know, this topic is slightly offbeat for at least the chartered accountants community, yet it's a very important one. Particularly when we have entrepreneurship as a focus, we have central government, the prime minister, everyone's talking about, you know, Startup India, Stand Up India, you know, bringing about transformation in smaller entities, smaller businesses to become larger, bigger, more profitable, unlocking value and so on. So this particular modes of funding can, you know, play a very pivotal role in transforming large numbers of businesses. And apparently as a percentage of GDP, there is a very large section, which is maybe 20 to 30%, which is in the unorganized sector. Maybe they are unincorporated. Maybe they operate as very small entities. And you know, these can actually grow at a better pace, in a nicer way, so that, you know, it does good to our country. And it results in wealth creation, job creation, and, you know, all the economic benefits that millions of people in India really need at this point of time. Recently, we have heard a lot about, you know, unconventional modes of funding, and crowdfunding is one of those. And BSE is playing this really special role to bring about SME listing, having certain other platforms where, you know, Startups can also, you know, participate in fundraising. So this is a very key initiative of this important exchange, which is, you know, sort of a monument for our whole nation and of our whole economy. So I would straight away introduce our next speaker, Mr. Neeraj Kulshrestha. He joined BSE as a Chief Operations Officer in 2015. He is responsible for trading, operations and development, listing, sales and operations, membership and IT operations. He's a member of the Executive Management Committee of the BSE and is on the boards of Indian Clearing Corporation Limited and Asia Index Private Limited. He has about 27 years of experience in capital markets, which includes security markets and general insurance. Prior to the BSE, he was an executive director in Morgan Stanley India for 10 years. Before that, he was with NSE and has managed various functions like trading operations, inspection and investigation, futures and options, clearing and trading. He was also CEO of India Index Services and Dotex International Limited. He has completed his bachelor's in computer science from Delhi University and MBA finance from Indore University. He'll be talking to us and giving us his opening remarks, which will be, and he will be followed by Mr. Ajay Thakur, who will be delivering his talk on you know, SME listing in particular, and that will have some interactions and, you know, any questions that you would like to ask. So I'll straight away request Vice President Chetan to present a memento on all our behalf as a mark of our appreciation and regard to Neeraj ji and also Ajay ji. Neeraj ji, over to you. I'll introduce Ajay ji, and the chairman will introduce Mahavir later on.
Thank you. So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome to all of you. I, on behalf of Bombay Chartered Accountants Society and the Bombay Stock Exchange, I welcome you all to this lecture on crowdfunding and SME listing, etc. I think this will, and I also welcome Mr. Mahavir Lunawat and Mr. Ajay Thakur. They are very popular names in this whole sector, and they are very well known. And I can assure you that you'll have a very fantastic session today. So they, in fact, their experience would be extremely invaluable to every one of you. So in that sense, I think this is a very apt time, as was explained earlier, because these are times when the government is extremely keen on Startup India, Stand Up India. Government is extremely keen on Make in India. So we all need to work together to ensure that how do we enable this whole environment or ecosystem so that we are capable of managing the next stage of growth. Funding, as I say, as we all know, is very vital for any entrepreneur or for any business. And many businesses have failed only because of lack of funding. Because of, at the time when they need the money, funding has not been available. When one is faced with these kind of hurdles, an entrepreneur would try to use all his resources to try to get funding from various sources. And the obvious source today, the first obvious source has been the banking system or the NBFCs. So I'll try to call it the banking system. That's been the traditional mode. Today, we would try to talk about, this whole session, we'd like to talk about alternative means of funding like crowdfunding and SME listing. We have of late, you know, startups have been very popular. I mean, in India, we have seen a sudden growth in startups. We can see newspapers dedicating a lot of space to startups. And that's been a very popular form of entrepreneurship which has come. So there's no lack of entrepreneurship. And India, after US, has seen some very significant growth in this particular segment. So as a result, you know, there is, and they all need funding. There are various mechanisms of funding which has been taking place. Crowdfunding and SME listing is probably one of the most apt sources of funding, and they have many advantages. And today, we would like to, in this session, we would like to give you some more information about these sources. To those of us for whom this subject is new, crowdfunding is nothing but a practice of funding a project from anyone or everyone. I mean, that's a very simple definition. So effectively, you need a large number of people who are ready to fund a project. You need a person with a very good idea. You need a large number of people who are ready to believe in that idea. And you need an intermediate platform. That's it. That intermediate platform can organize, can bring together these two different sets of people, and which can be done. And that's where most of this whole environment or ecosystem takes place. Crowdfunding, it has been a new mode of funding. It is fairly, we can't really call it a very recent phenomenon. In fact, interestingly, I was going through some history. So the first case of crowdfunding was in 1800s, when the Statue of Liberty was moved from France to US. Interestingly, the anecdote says that at that time, while the statue reached the shores of the United States, no one had planned to build a platform. And so at that time, there was an ad which had to be taken out in the newspapers, and people funded around $150,000 or $160,000 just to build that platform. So that's the first known case of crowdfunding. And similarly, there have been significant developments in the crowdfunding platforms, like, you have in equity, you have in debt, you have crowdfunding platforms which are specific to tasks, like you have a lot of legal crowdfunding which happens in US for public interest related litigation. But there is also a significant chunk which happens in charity. And I'll come to that in a minute. One of the significant pieces has been the debt crowdfunding, which is to do with, in the UK, for example, the statistics talk about in 2014, around £750 million of crowdfunding which took place, of which £550 million was only towards the retail sector. So that's a very significant number, and that would have grown in 2015. In the US, of course, the figure is much higher. It's around $5 billion or something of crowdfunding only in the debt segment. We have segments in India. We have, for example, there are startups in India. There's a startup called Keto, which is doing a lot of social crowdfunding. They've already, funded 4,000 plus projects up to maximum is 10 crores or something. I mean, that's what they've done. Which is again, and I mean, I was just reading an example that for the Chennai floods, they were able to collect around 24 lakh rupees. Just people ready to pay. So, it has been a platform. The advantage of these kind of platforms are that you do not have the rigorous kind of process that you have for banking finance, which is required. No documentation, no formal documentation in that sense, or maybe very, very reduced, and ease. So things are much more relaxed. But at the end, it's a very informal mechanism. And so therefore, then that brings me to the next point, which is on SME. Now, SME is a very significant contributor in this country. While we may feel it's a small sector, but it has a very large impact. It is a very important sector for the socio-economic development of the country. If we understand the extent, there are around 6,000 plus products which are being manufactured by this sector. There are around 40 million units which are into this sector, with providing employment to around 100 million people. It contributes to around 8 to 10% of our GDP, which is a very significant number again. They contribute to around 45% of our manufacturing output and 40% of our exports. So look at the hugeness of this. Recognizing this, what we did at BSC was to set up a dedicated segment for this, towards this segment, where more than 120 companies are listed. Since Mr. Ajay Thakur is an expert in this, so I would not really talk a lot about that, but you can see this sector, which started in 2012, we have done a great job in terms of getting the companies to list, and the companies have gained significantly after listing here. So that's the positive side. But the inner depths of this segment, I think Ajay is the right person to talk about that. So on that note, I would close here, and I invite you to ensure that, you know, you are very interactive and take all the benefit that you can from this session. And I hope that at the end of it, I mean, there'll be some gain with respect to all these topics. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Very good evening to all of you, and very warm welcome once again. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a function organized by BAC jointly with the BCAS. Nevertheless, I have a very strong belief to recognize the efforts put up by the people for organizing this function. And I think it's a long time pending for us to have a function over here. It's not possible without the efforts put up by the Bombay Stock Exchange. We have their representatives either as speaker or as a keynote address, as well as the other speaker. So may I request you all to join in giving a very warm welcome to Mr. Neeraj, Mr. Ajay, and Mr. Mahavir. Can I request you to join? My job has been made simplified both by the President and Ajay by giving some thoughts on that, but I'll try to make some additional efforts to say, having given the opportunity to speak over here. The President did refer to the BCAS. Let me share that we strongly believe in sharing the knowledge, and our all programs are held for sharing the knowledge with chartered accountants, with the students' community at large, and with the public at large. So this is a function organized for the public at large. We have various subcommittees, and one of the committees is the Corporate and Allied Laws Committee, which is organized, where I happens to be a chairman of the committee, and this function is organized by the committee. The society is one of the most prestigious book that is called as the monthly journal. If you happen to travel in the corridors of the income tax office at New Delhi, I use the word New Delhi, or you travel to the service tax office at Chennai, you will find that the advocates, I am using the word advocate, will be carrying the journal of the society in their hands. It's one of the most acclaimed journal, I would say, with all proud as a past president, one of the most acclaimed journal for the professional, maybe if I use the word not so wrong, in Asia. And it's a very well deserved journal published by the society. We have various activities, and I'll only refer to one additional activity as this committee is doing, is to organize regular program on the corporate governance. This committee had been responsible, particularly when the BSE representatives are present here, to say that we have trained as many as 100 people from the three fields of army of the Government of India in the Ministry of Defense, including the top heads, the army general, the next head, and we have trained almost 100 chartered accountants, the head of finance, various high profile individuals, trained to be eligible to be independent directors of the various companies, and which of course would also include various women, when now there is a clause for the woman director. And this committee organizes every year a program on the said subject. Having said subject about the society, we have this meeting on the two subjects. Well, I am not an expert on crowdfunding. I only know that crowdfunding would mean that the crowd is offering the funds to you. That's the only simple answer that I would take it as a layman. As said by Neeraj, that it's a means of raising money for a creative project or a public interest cause. He also mention about the funds that could be raised by the startup. I think the President used that word. We have Ajay Thakur, who is going to take us. We have Mr. Mahavir Lunawat going to take up on the subject. We have another subject that is on the SME listing. When at the initial stage of the practice we had been listening that the requirement of the net worth of the listing on the stock exchange subject to approval by the then controlling auditor general or the controlling authority at New Delhi is some 25 lakhs or 5 lakhs or, and with the development of the finance, the financial growth in the country, those limits have been substantially raised. So what happened to those other small and medium enterprises, we call it as SME in short form. Naturally, they also need to have the funds to grow up. Various criteria has been prescribed for the same, and we are happy to note that BSE is very strongly promoting the same, and Mr. Ajay Thakur is heading the same, and is going to take us on the detail on the said subject. It will not be so correct to me on my part to say more on the subject, but nevertheless, we have two speakers over here. The first one, Mr. Ajay Thakur, is going to take us on the subject. So I'll make a very brief introduction about Mr. Ajay Thakur. In 1996, the BSE was fortunate to have Ajay Thakur on their cards. He started with the arbitration and business development. He has traveled almost 2 decades with the BSE, and with those very strong capital market experience, he is now heading BSE SME. And we are proud to say he is the one responsible for the particular segment of SME listing of the BSE for the development and carrying out the same. On 13th March 12, for all of us, including particularly for Mr. Ajay Thakur, he launched the SME platform at the BSE, and large number of companies and have been all listed over here at the BSE. I'm not going to take to the numbers, etc. over here, but with these words, may I request all of you to once again join to welcome Mr. Ajay Thakur, and may I request Mr. Ajay Thakur to address us on the subject. Thank you.
Eminent personalities on the dais, Sri Neeraj Kulshrestha, Chief of Business Operations, BSE, Sri Raman Jokharkar, President BCAS, Sri Kanu Bhai Choksi, Chairman, Sri Mahavir Lunawat, the Merchant Banker, CMD of Pentamoth, Sri Chetan Sa, Vice President, Sri Mati Piti Oja, distinguished guests, very good evening to all of you. Now you are seeing it's written 140. It means that we are into existence for last 140 years. And most of the time I say that we are older than the oldest political party of this country. That is Indian National Congress. In fact, we are 10 years older than Indian National Congress. If you see the wealth that Bombay Stock Exchange has created in last 140 years, it is almost $1.2 trillion, or we can say 100 lakh crores. It's a big amount, it's a large amount. At the same time, in 140 years, we have been able to list only 5,600 companies. And out of that, just 3,000 companies are traded actively on BSE, Bombay Stock Exchange platform. But just only 3,000 companies has created a market capitalization of $1.2 trillion. So this much of wealth has been created in this country by this institution, and we are really proud to be the part of this institution. And especially myself, I have been the part of this institution for 2 decades. 2 or 3 times I have thought of leaving this organization, but whenever I thought of leaving the organization, the market tanked. And I thought that I will not get the job anywhere. So I thought better to stick with this organization, do something great. And the better I stick with the organization, the better, the more proud I felt about this organization. Let me tell you one more thing. Till 2007, we were a non-profit making association organization. Our goal was not making profit. After 2007, in fact, the government told us to make ourselves a profit-making organization, limited company, and that's why we made the limited company. If you see the transaction cost that we are charging on the company which are being traded on the stock exchange, just 275 rupees per crore, which is nothing. So we have, in all these years, we have tried to create wealth for the system. We want to create large companies. We want to create blue chip companies. Whether you talk about Reliance, Infosys, Wipro, or Tata's, Telcos, Birla's, all these people have been created by this great institution, by this great organization. And at some or other point of time, all these companies were a small company. If you talk about Reliance Industries, you know, it has come into existence somewhere in 1980, right, Mahavirji? With a market capitalization of 11 crores. And in 35 years, Reliance Industries has created a market capitalization of 3 lakh crores. In 1980, we have created Sensex with 100 as base. Today it is 25,000. So it has almost given a return of 24,000%. So what has happened in last 10 years, we have, you know, created large companies, blue chip companies, etc. But in last 10 years, there's some issue. So in last 10 years, what we have seen is that slowly, some companies have tried to create some problems, and we have made the rules and regulation more stringent. So some of the SMEs and their association has approached to the Prime Minister, and they said that we want an alternative source of funding. And Prime Minister in India, you know, for everything, not a single person takes all the responsibility. They form a committee. And accordingly, a committee was formed under the Principal Secretary, Mr. Nair. And he has recommended that there should be a dedicated stock exchange for the SME companies. And accordingly, SEBI, Security Exchange Board of India, has come out with a guideline on 18th May 2010. And according to these guidelines, the companies, small and medium companies, can get listed on the platform of the Bombay Stock Exchange. Now, what these guidelines say that any company having post-issue paid up capital up to 10 crore has to compulsory get listed on the SME platform of the stock exchange. Any company having post-issue paid up capital between 10 to 25 crore has the option either to get listed on the SME platform of the stock exchange, or they can get listed on the main board of the stock exchange. And beyond 25 crore of post-issue paid up capital, they have to compulsory get listed on the main board of the stock exchange. Most of the criteria on the SEDR guidelines have been relaxed. So any company which is even a new company, or they have come into existence just 1 year back, they can also get listed on the stock exchange if post-issue paid up capital is below 10 crores. So this guideline has come. Besides that, they have introduced three new concepts. One was the concept of market making. Earlier, market making is prevalent in the country for almost 120 years in our country. We used to say jobbers. So this was the trading platform. The here open outcry system used to take place. And these jobbers were there. They were experts on their own stocks. And they used to provide two-way quotes. They were ready to buy, say for the example, the price of share is 50 rupees. So they were ready to buy at 50 and sell at 52 rupees. So 2 rupees was the spread that they used to keep between buy and sell, and that spread was their income. So we used to call them jobbers, but we have the tendency to take the words from the foreign market and international market. So jobber was replaced by the word market maker, but both are one and the same. And the next concept that was introduced in this platform was of underwriting. See, all the issues need to be 100% underwritten by the merchant banker. And 15% of that he has to write on his own books. But if the syndicate members who have taken the underwriting of the difference amount. If they are unable to comply with these requirements, then the whole responsibility goes on the hands of merchant banker. So merchant banker is responsible to see that the company which has come out with issue gets listed. So a lot of responsibility was put on the merchant banker. Third concept that was introduced here was the concept of lot size. So what they said that if anybody wants to invest on SME platform, they have to invest minimum 1 lakh rupees. So say for example, a company is coming out with an issue price of rupees 50. You divide 1 lakh by 50, so 2,000 shares becomes the lot size. So if anybody wants to buy the shares, he has to buy minimum 2,000 shares or multiple thereof. That is 4,000, 6,000, 8,000. There was no concept of odd lot. And the same way, those scrips will be traded on the main board or on the secondary board of the stock exchange after listing. So in the secondary market also, it will be in the terms of lot only. So market making concept was there, underwriting concept was there, and this market making was minimum for 3 years. And third concept was of lot size of rupees 1 lakh. It was there for why they have kept of rupees 1 lakh, because they want the informed investors to invest in this company who can stick to the companies for longer time. Now all these concepts were new. We have a legacy of OTCI which has failed miserably, and wherever we used to go, we used to listen from the people, and people would sarcastically ask us the questions that when OTCI has failed, whether this SME platform is going to succeed or not. So there were a lot of pessimism in the market. But Bombay Stock Exchange, because we have created the equity culture into the market, what we have done, we have gone with this concept, and we thought that we will talk to the promoters of the various company, we will talk to the merchant bankers, and we will try to get more and more company listed on the SME platform of the stock exchange. So on 13th March 2012, Bombay Stock Exchange launched this SME platform with the listing of company called BCB Finance. And from there, the journey starts, and today we have reached to 120. I can't take the success of this platform only on myself, as Kanu Bhai has said. The success of this SME platform is mostly on the intermediaries, on the merchant bankers like Mahavir Ji, and many other merchant bankers and intermediaries, because we can't, you know, start this SME platform on our own, because we as a regulator can't bring the issues on this platform. So all the success goes to the merchant bankers, those promoters who have shown confidence in us to see that this SME platform take off. And in this process, the SME platform keep on getting created. We were only responsible for to provide good services to the SME company. But you know, equity is something, you know, which is very risky instrument. I always say that equity is the safest instrument in the hands of the promoters and riskiest instrument in the hands of investors. We have seen thousands of examples of rich promoters and poor investors. So we have to be very careful, you know, while launching any platform, because success takes a long time, but failure or bad name comes in seconds. So we have to be very careful that while launching the SME platform, there should be a balance between regulation and relaxation. And accordingly, we have introduced some eligibility criteria on this SME platform. What we said, that minimum post-issue paid-up capital of the company should be 1 crore, minimum net worth should be 1 crore, minimum net tangible assets should be 1 crore, company should have at least 2 years of distributable profit. And slowly, we have increased the threshold level. We have increased the eligibility criteria. And presently, the eligibility criteria says that minimum post-issue face value capital of the company should be 3 crores, minimum net tangible assets should be 3 crores, minimum net worth of the company should be 3 crores, and there should be 2 years of distributable profit in the company. In case there is no distributable profit for 2 years, then the company's post-issue face value capital should, then the company net worth should be minimum 5 crores. So three guidelines as far as financial eligibility criteria is concerned that we have introduced in the SME platform is that minimum post-issue face value capital should be 3 crores, minimum net worth should be 3 crores, minimum net tangible assets should be 3 crores with 2 years of distributable profit. If there is no 2 years of distributable profit, then the net worth should be 5 crores. Besides that, what we said that there were some qualitative criteria that we have put in this SME platform. What we said that the company should be traded only in dematerialized form. So they need to sign the agreements with both the depositories, CDSL and NSDL, so that there should be proper fungibility in these stocks. Second, we said that companies should not have been referred to BIFR. If the company has been referred to BIFR, then we are not going to allow these companies to get listed on the SME platform of the stock exchange. And there should be no winding up petition against the company which has been accepted by the competent court of jurisdiction. So these were the qualitative criteria, and besides that, all these companies should have their own website. So these were the eligibility criteria that have been put by us so that only growth-oriented companies shall get listed on the SME platform of the stock exchange. Now, as far as contribution of SME is concerned, already my earlier speakers have talked about that, what should be the, what are their contribution onto the economic, on the ecosystem, in the economic system. But for me, I think their major contribution is in the employment. They are the largest generator of the employment after agriculture sector. And the report says, there is some report which says that in coming, we have got demographic dividend, we are going to have the maximum young people. But at the same time, we should also understand that these young people, we have to provide employment to these young people. And how many people are going to add into the system in coming 10 years is 25 crore people. So these 25 crore people have to be given the job. So this is advantage that we have got young English-speaking people, but at the same time it can be curse also to us if there will be unrest, if we are unable to provide them the job. So for all of us, it is very important to see that these SME companies should grow in double digits. We should provide them the finance. Now in most of the program when I go and normally what we see that people are talking about finance. That company requires finance, they should be given the finance. But I think there are other reasons for companies also to have credibility, to have goodwill, so that people should move forward and give them the money. So as a stock exchange, the role of the stock exchange is not only to generate finance, but there are various other roles that are associated. And there are various other benefits that are associated with the companies which are going to get listed on the stock exchange. Now what are the benefits that the company get out of listing on the stock exchange? Number one, their credibility. Their credibility increases manifold because there is a corporate governance. In most of the SME companies which are not in unlisted space, what we find that the promoter is everything. Okay, it's like that there is a movie where the promoter is the script writer, he's the director, he's the producer, he's music writer, he's music composer, everything is the promoter. So if you want to know anything about the company, you have to approach to the promoter. Now with the listing, what happens is that, you know, there is a corporate governance that comes into play. So what we see that there are 50% promoters who are sitting on the board, and there are 50% independent directors. And because of the mixture of professional directors and promoter directors, we see the credibility of the company increases manifold. The transparency comes into the company. The company starts moving from taxation model to wealth creation model. You know, most of the companies in last 4 years, I have done around 500 seminars or events where I have gone, around 500. I have met around more than 15,000 promoters. And most of the balance sheet what I have seen is that the top line is very good, the bottom line is very big. So there are two things because of which this is the situation. One may be because of the taxation issue, that taxation model is there. We don't want to so much of the profit. And second is that the companies are over-leveraged. They are very much dependable on bank funding. They have taken a huge bank fund for everything. For working capital, there is bank funding. For expansion, acquisition, everything, there is a bank funding. So there is a lot of dependence on bank funding, and because of which, bottom line is squished. So when equity funds comes inside, the balance sheet becomes healthy, the balance sheet becomes strong, the profit goes up. And when the profit goes up, the valuation of the company starts unfolding. So this is another benefit that we see after listing. Of course, when all these things start coming, you see that finance also starts coming at different valuation. Maybe the company, when it gets listed, it may be at 20 crore valuation. May going forward at 100 crore valuation, they start getting fund. So valuation starts unfolding, and at different valuation, the company starts getting money. And because all these things comes into place, you see that a lot of private equity, high net worth individual, and those who are rich people, they want to put funds into the company. So automatically funds starts coming into the company, and the company become large company or blue chip company or whatever you see. So all these ecosystems start getting created only when the company gets listed on the SME platform of the stocks. Most of the time I say that equity is just like the currency of the company. Okay, for example, what is rupee or what is dollar? I say that, okay, we say it currency, but it's nothing but it's the equity of the country. Dollar is nothing but the equity of the country. In the same way, when you are issuing the equity, you are issuing your own currency. And the performance of your equity depends upon the performance of the company. In the way, you know, and at the same time, you don't owe any liability. Say, for example, you are issuing a share at 100 rupees. If it comes down to 80 rupees, you are not giving the difference amount to the investors. Okay, but at the same time, if you are giving collateral to the banks, and if the collateral value comes down, you have to give additional collateral to the banks. But in the case of equity, that risk is not there on the company. In the same way, say for example, you have done some currency deal, and whereby you have dealt at 60 rupees and it has fallen down to 67 rupees or 68 rupees, you are not liable to make the difference. The country is not liable to make the difference amount good, that is 7 rupees. So it is the market which is going to play the role. In the same way, equity is your currency, which you can use for the advantage of your own company. So that's what we keep on talking about the company. Equity is nothing but an intangible asset. Okay, it only gives you, say for example, you are running your company. You are running the company today. You are going to run your company in the future also. So all the fixed assets, everything is of the company. Even after listing, it will remain in the company. But with listing, you are going to get additional valuation. Say for example, you are doing 100 crore of business and 5 crores of profit. So that profit is anyhow going to come into the company. But because of 5 crores of profit, you are going to have a 100 crore valuation into the capital market. So if you keep on diluting, you keep on getting money into the market. If we are talking about Mukesh Ambani is the richest person in the country, it's not that he is having 1 lakh crore rupees in his bank account. It's only because he is having 38% stake of Reliance industry. And that's why he is the richest person. If Nandan Nilkani was the richest candidate in the last Lok Sabha election, it was only because he was holding the shares of Infosys. So equity not only creates wealth for the company, it also creates for the promoters, it also creates for the individual. It also creates a hierarchy system. Succession plan also you can make out of the company because it's in the listed space. And another government, what incentive the government has given? Government has given a lot of incentives. Number one, long-term capital gain tax is zero in the equity market. So for example, today you bought the share at 50 rupees. After 1 year, you are selling at 150 rupees. And the 100 rupees profit that you are making on that, you don't have to pay any tax. And as far as short-term capital gain tax is concerned, it's just 15%. Even if you are selling your equity above the book value in the capital market, you don't have to pay tax. But in case you are selling in the unlisted space, you have to pay 33% tax. So government has also given a lot of incentive for the companies which are going to get listed. So all these benefits are there for the companies to get listed. And SME platform is giving an opportunity to the promoters to get listed in a very cost-effective manner. Within 3 to 4 months, the companies get listed. We are not happy with the number of 120, though we are a market leader, having 93% of market share. But the potential this country has, the number of companies that this country has of 3 crores or 4 crores company with just 5% in the private or public sector, and even if I am taking 1%, 25 lakh, and even I am taking 1%, it comes to 25,000, which are eligible to get listed on the SME platform of the stock exchange. So the number that we are seeing is a very big number. We are not totally satisfied. We are not totally happy with whatever is the number we have. And that's why we are going to all these events, and we are talking to the organizers so that this information should reach to the maximum promoters, and they can take benefit of listing. Before I finish, just normally I give the example of Mahabharata talking about the strength of the equity. And with your permission, I would like to speak in Hindi. Mahabharata Ramayana, ye sab Hindi mein hi bolne mein zyada acha lagta hai. Ya nahi to fir Sanskrit. Sanskrit to hum samajhte nahi hai zyada. To equity kya hai, wo aap isse aap nikal sakte hain. Ki Shri Krishna Bhagwan ne Duryodhan aur Arjun dono ko bataya कि आप दोनों में से जो पहले कल आओगे मैं उसके ही तरफ से युद्ध में रहूंगा। उन्होंने ये नहीं बोला कि मैं लड़ूंगा, उन्होंने बोला मैं उनके तरफ से रहूंगा। तो दुर्योधन पहले पहुंचा, लेकिन वो सर के पास था, क्योंकि बड़ा भाई था, उसको अपना ईगो में ठेस लगा, तो उसने सोचा कि मैं सर के पास रहूंगा। और अर्जुन भी गया, अर्जुन जो था पैर के पास था, तो श्री कृष्ण जी उठे और सबसे पहले उन्होंने देखा अर्जुन को, तो बोला कि हम पांडव की तरह से रहेंगे। लेकिन दुर्योधन जो था उसने बोला कि नहीं, मैं पहले आया था, आपने ये नहीं बोला कि पहले किसको देखोगे, पहले मैं आया था, तो पहले आपको मेरे साथ ही रहना पड़ेगा। और उम्र में भी दुर्योधन बड़ा था, बड़े भाई की तरह था, तो उसकी बात वो काट नहीं सकते थे श्री कृष्ण जी। लेकिन श्री कृष्ण जी को एक बात मालूम था कि ये जो है बंदा, ये विजनरी प्रमोटर नहीं है, मतलब ये धीरू भाई अम्बानी नहीं है, वो छोटी मोटी कंपनी वाला है, तो ये विजनरी प्रमोटर नहीं है। जबकि उनको मालूम था अर्जुन जो है वो विजनरी प्रमोटर है। तो उसने बोला कि देखो भाई, रिलेशन में तुम दोनों हमारे रिलेटिव लगते हो, मैं किसी के भी तरफ से युद्ध नहीं कर सकता हूँ, तुम्हारे पास एक ऑप्शन है। तो बोला क्या? देखो मैं युद्ध तो करूँगा नहीं, लेकिन मेरी ये जो सेना है, नारायणी सेना उसको कहा जाता था, काफ़ी बड़ी सेना थी, तुम उसको अपने साथ ले लो। तो दुर्योधन ने सोचा यार ये बात तो सही कहता है, तो सिर्फ बक बक करते रहता और हम लोग को डिस्टर्ब करेगा बहुत, तो इससे अच्छा और युद्ध भी नहीं करेगा, इससे अच्छा बेटर है कि नारायणी सेना ही ले लिया जाए। और उसने नारायणी सेना अडॉप्ट किया, नारायणी सेना ले लिया। उसका परिणाम क्या हुआ? युद्ध में कौन जीता? नारायणी सेना ने युद्ध किया था, श्री कृष्ण तो युद्ध नहीं किया, पांडव की तरफ थे, लेकिन जीता कौन? जीता पांडव। मैं ये कहानी क्यों निकाला और इसका कोई तात्पर्य नहीं है, लेकिन ये मैंने कहानी की एग्जांपल इसलिए दी कि श्री कृष्ण जो है, जो आपको नहीं दिख रहे या जो चीज है जो वो कर रहे हैं, आप श्री कृष्ण को समझ सकते हैं इक्विटी, और जो नारायणी सेना दिख रही है ना, वो आप समझ सकते हो डेट फंडिंग के तरह का। अगर किसी भी कंपनी को बड़ा बनना है, किसी कंपनी को बहुत आगे बनना, तो मैं ये नहीं कह रहा हूँ कि आप डेट फंडिंग मत लो, लेकिन आपको श्री कृष्ण रूपी इक्विटी फंड ही जो है वो प्रमोटर्स को आगे बढ़ा सकता है। आज जितनी भी कंपनियां इंडिया में आप बड़ी बनी, अगर मैं 100 लाख करोड़ की मार्केट कैपिटलाइजेशन की बात करता हूँ, तो वो संभव नहीं था अगर उन्होंने इक्विटी फंड की रूट नहीं ली होती। मार्केट में आप डेट फंडिंग उठा सकते हो, जब अच्छी सिचुएशन रहती है तो बहुत सारे लोग पैम्परिंग करने के लिए भी आ जाते हैं। मेनी पीपल यू विल फाइंड यू विल पैम्पर एंड यू विल से दैट बॉस देयर इज नॉट ए सिंगल इवन धीरू भाई अंबानी इज नॉट एज ए गुड प्रमोटर एज यू आर, सो कीप ऑन एक्सपेंडिंग योर बिजनेस एंड यू कीप ऑन टेकिंग लोन लोन लोन, बट वंस द इकोनॉमिक साइकिल कम्स डाउन देन यू स्टार्ट फीलिंग द पिंच एंड मोस्ट ऑफ द कंपनीज बिकम बैंकक्रप्ट बिकॉज ऑफ द ह्यूज डेट दे हैव टेकन इनटू द सिस्टम। एट द सेम टाइम ह्यूज इक्विटी इज ऑल्सो नॉट गुड, एक्सट्रीम ऑफ एनीथिंग बैड, अति सर्वत्र वर्जित, संस्कृत में कहावत है अति सर्वत्र वर्जित, एक्सट्रीम ऑफ एनीथिंग इज बैड, सो लेट अस हैव ए बैलेंस ऑफ बोथ डेट एंड इक्विटी एंड बॉम्बे स्टॉक एक्सचेंज इज प्रोवाइडिंग डेट, वी आर द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन हु हैज क्रिएटेड इक्विटी कल्चर इन दिस कंट्री, वी आर टेकिंग ईच एंड एवरी स्टेप टू सी दैट ए प्रॉपर इको सिस्टम शुड गेट क्रिएटेड इन टू द मार्केट एंड लेट मी एश्योर यू ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ बॉम्बे स्टॉक एक्सचेंज ऑन बिहाफ एज ए हेड ऑफ SME प्लेटफॉर्म that all those promoters, all those intermediaries who will approach to the stock exchange will be given red carpet welcome and the best service to them under the regulatory framework of a stock exchange. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Ajay sir. I did like your words while saying that a person gets a reputation as one of the advantages of SME listing. At the same time, there were some thoughts in my mind. Of course, I am not knowing the subject fully. Still, I am venturing to say something on that, that we may look into the compliances that we have at present for the presently listed companies compared to SME listing. I'm sure there could be a lot of reduction in the same. Whatever authority as a past president I have, taking the suggestion given by Shri Ajay, we are happy to invite the BSE under the guidance of Ajay, if they could make us some series of articles over a period of time on the subject of SME listing, starting with the introduction of the subject, then the process of listing, the compliances, the taxation, of course, we would also support. And we would be more than happy to publish in our journal on a regular basis, and thereby it would become a memento to be available and to be referred by everybody. So I request, of course it's the domain of our journal committee and not directly of my committee, but naturally we all work in a group. So our president would take over in consultation with journal committee and ensure that those articles are published, whereby public at large, because our journal circulation is more than 10,000, public at large would be definitely at the advantage. Sir, once again, we are thankful to you for addressing us and supporting in this activity. Well, I continue with what I said in the beginning. So let me recognize the effort by some more people that the idea was conceived by the convener of our committee, Samir Kapadia, who is present over here. May I request you to recognize the efforts put up by him? The entire process was a one-man show from the Bombay Chartered Accountants Society side. None other than, of course, the ladies are always forward in that, and that is Preeti Oza, our convener. She is sitting over here. She is very shy to come out, but then nevertheless, I'll fail in my duty if I do not recognize the effort. And thereafter, of course, our president, vice president, they took the lead further with the support of Ajay sir and others at the BSE to carry on the same. Well, coming to our learned speaker of the evening, let me first very sincere thanks to him express that he just landed in the evening and he ensured that he is here to make up his commitment. Sir, we are very much thankful to you on that part. In our chartered account fraternity, when the results of the exams are announced, it is very important that who is the gold medalist. And we have the other professional field, company secretary field, where we have a gold medalist of the company secretary sitting here, Mr. Mahavir Lunawat. He has been doing his own business as the managing director of Pentamos Advisory Services. He has been very active in authoring the books on behalf of SEBI. The monumental book of SEBI also of 2010 has been done by him. He has been active in the activities of more on related to the finances and more on the funding, and in fact in the SME listing also he is very active. He had given various lectures at various forums. Ajay said 5,000 or 500, and he also would have given as many lectures at various forums. Had been very active on the various forums, and I think it is almost more than 13 years that he is active in the capital market. We definitely recognize his efforts and would like to take the advantage of the efforts put up by him. And I'm sure he is going to take us very delightful journey on the subject allotted to him. We welcome our learned speaker, Mr. Mahavir Lunawat, with a memento to be presented on behalf of all of us. May I request Preeti Oza to come forward and present a memento to Mr. Mahavir Lunawat. Sir, don't look at the size compared to Ajay, it's all same in a lighter way. So don't worry on that there is something special or something, it's all same. Nevertheless, sir, may I request our learned speaker to take us on the subject.
All, Mr. Ajay Thakur, President, Vice President, Society, Chairman of the Program Organizing Committee, Program Coordinators, incidentally both of them have been my dear friends, so thank you very much for putting up a great program together, and all the esteemed fellow professionals and friends. Thank you for the kind words, Chairman sir, and the disclosure on the size of the memento. I think that to me, it's not a very ordinary statement, and that's what the entire ecosystem expects from professionals like us in terms of transparency and more in terms of disclosures, and so is in the case of SME IPOs and crowdfunding and such important aspects. So with this note, I think we are slightly behind schedule, but I'll try to manage within the given time so that we can have more interaction, so maybe I'll skip some of the slides. Nevertheless, we'll keep those slides at the circulation for the benefit of all the members. Views are purely personal and need not be the views of institute or any of the committees where I represent. Very important subject, much has been said about the platforms for raising growth capital. Are these subjects new? Probably not as far as global context is concerned, but definitely they are emerging as far as Indian context is concerned. There have been various platforms over a period of last 3 to 4 years. SME is, of course, it may not be actually very appropriate to term it as a new, but yes, it's very growing platform and growing very fast. There has been another platform of listing without IPO on institutional trading platform, which is which has been prevalent in United States for good number of years. Of course, India also, there was an attempt made, but recently there was complete revamp of that platform, and listing without IPO is now more of a distant dream. However, the same platform has been modified for startups, where startups can come up for an IPO, which is not subject to the conventional rules and regime of IPO. And of course, crowdfunding, particularly I like the approach of the society that it always discusses on, you know, newer and emerging concepts proactively before even crowdfunding concept is set. I mean, I'm very pleased that you all have slated this topic for discussion. So it's not a regulation, it's not a reality in a structured terms, but yes, the concept is there, and there have been few attempts which have been made, although largely remains unstructured as of now. So these are the platforms which probably is the subject matter of discussion for this evening. Basically, these are nothing but equity raising platforms. When any company come up with an IPO and raises funds, they have to list their shares on the stock exchange. That's the fundamental rule of the land in terms of the Companies Act and SEBI regulations. And we have recently come across a lot of unfortunate incidents of corporates raising crores of rupees without coming an IPO. That may be called a collective scheme or maybe any other innovative name, but any such fundraising beyond the permitted limit of investors, let's say 200 in the new Companies Act and rules, that has to be through an IPO. That's the norm. And in that context, the exchanges were set up and they have been doing wonderful jobs. But unfortunately, in India, there was always a single regime of raising funds. So what a regulatory framework or IPO framework will apply for a company like Reliance or Infosys will also apply for company like any company like, let's say, UltraCab or MD Indacto or some of those companies which have got listed on SME platform with turnover of 30 crore, 50 crore, 100 crore. So how a company with 5,000 crore or 10,000 crore of turnover can be equated with company of 5 crore to 50 crore? So in that context, this platform was never available to emerging companies or SMEs, whatever name we call it. And they were, as rightly stated, always dependent on bank funding and personal finance. 2010, Prime Minister Task Force, which was referred by Ajay Sir, fundamental recommendation was that dedicated platforms should be set up, and in that context we are having these platforms. So we'll take up these three platforms one by one, but other two are more on the drawing board as of now, so probably we'll spend more time on the first one, and then last 5-10 minutes we'll touch upon those other two platforms as well. SME importance, 60% employment, 40% exports, a lot of importance, and in that context this platform has been launched. 5 key conditions, if one has to ask. 25% minimum public shareholding is universal, whether it's an IPO on main board or on SME. 25% has to be a minimum public float. Minimum investors, the number has been significantly reduced from 1,000 in the main board to 50 on the SME. Peculiar feature is the lot size is 1 lakh of rupees in value terms. So both primary as well as secondary trades happen, or applications are only in lot size of 1 lakh of rupees. So if price is 20, then I as an investor can apply 5,000, or even after listing I can trade only in 5,000, 10,000, 15,000. Unlike in main board, I cannot have 2, 5, 10, 100 any lot. It has to be in the lots whose value is minimum 1 lakh of rupees. And these lot size requirements or framework is reviewed by exchange periodically. So if let's say the initial price is 20 and later on the price moves to 40 or 60, then lot size are reduced such that the minimum lot size remains in and around rupees 1 lakh. Market making is concept, very beautifully explained, very simplified by Ajay sir in terms of the role of market making. So that's again a very good feature of SME. So 130 companies that got already listed, although Ajay sir has said that it's not up to his expectation, but from market point of view, in today's challenging scenario when hardly any activity is seen, barring let's say last couple of months where a lot of IPOs are getting announced, and a lot of main board IPOs are even failing to witness the success. In that context, 50 companies on an average coming and listing every year on an emerging platform like SME, this is a phenomenal achievement of Bombay Stock Exchange and capital market as a whole. The market capital of the SME platform, you'll be happy to note that that has peaked 10,000 crore, and the average price increase is 8 to 9 times in this practically period of less than 3 years, if we exclude the first 6 months or 8 months, because that largely went to developmental activities. As per the study, internationally, this market is the fastest growing, and the returns in terms of percentage, that is the biggest. So both in terms of number and value, the BSE SME has been the role model, and I think it gives a lot of pleasure that even the international bodies like Asian Development Bank, IOSCO, that they are replicating this exchange, and they have invited recently Ajay sir to one of their roundtable discussions. So I think big round of applause for Mr. Ajay Thakur. In terms of some key trends, the minimum IPO size is less than a crore, and the maximum IPO size is 43 crore. The minimum turnover is less than 5 crore, and the maximum turnover is 600 crore. So a lot of times we come across, and why I'm sharing these trends is that when we go to our clients or when we go to our circles, then a lot of times people have apprehensions, hearsay, in terms of this is a small platform, this is not meant for us. Then we'll have to tell them that no, even companies with 300 crore turnover, 400 crore turnover, 500 crore turnover, 600 crore turnover, they have also come on this platform and that have got listed. Average IPO size is less than 10 crore. So any company with a good business model, they can consider listing on these platforms. A lot of times companies say that I have only 10 crore of turnover or 40 crore of turnover or 25 crore of turnover. So we can safely say that what matters on this exchange is business model, the scalability and sustainability, and not necessarily the existing size of the business. The companies have come from various cities, 25 cities across. Of course, Maharashtra takes the lead, followed by Gujarat and NCR, Delhi. Briefly, I think norms have been touched upon by Ajayji very in a simplified manner, but just for the completeness sake, any company with post-issue paid-up capital of 1 crore and maximum capital not exceeding 25 crore is eligible for listing on SME platforms. Companies which have 10 crore of paid up capital, they have option to list either on the main board or on the SME. So 1 to 10 necessarily only mutually exclusively on SME, 10 to 25 option, and beyond 25 mutually exclusive on main board. MSME Act defines SMEs differently. That definition is linked to the investment in plant and machinery. So that definition has got no relevance as far as listing on capital market is concerned. So even if a company has, let's say, 50 crore of investment in plant and machinery, but capital is less than 25 crore, that company will still be termed as SME for the purpose of listing. Lot size we discussed, 100% underwritten, that has already been discussed. And one important feature of this platform is that after 2 years of completion on SME, if the capital of the company is 10 crore or more, company can migrate onto the main board seamlessly. And all those main board IPO regulations, like minimum operating profit of 15 crore per annum for at least 3 years, so on and so forth, they are exempt. So that's a very, very facilitative and beautiful provision that even a company of, let's say, 25 crore, 50 crore can come up with an IPO of 2 crore, 5 crore, 10 crore, list on SME, capitalize the company to the extent of 10 crore, be there on the board for 2 years, and after 2 years, it can migrate. And that's not a theoretical provision. 13 companies have already got migrated, and BSE has been hand-holding those companies throughout, right from listing and, of course, on and after migration. Besides the SEBI framework, there is BSE norms, which also are equally important, and 3 crore of net tangible assets, 3 crore of net worth. If a company is newly incorporated, or if the company doesn't have a distributable surplus track record of 2 out of preceding 3 years, then also a company can list, and in that case the net worth will be, minimum net worth requirement will be 5 crore. So a lot of times we come across clients that I have newly incorporated or newly ventured into a project, can I list? The answer is in affirmative, subject of course to that company having net worth of 5 crore of rupees. So a lot of differences between main board, SME, and of course it is I'm happy to share that a lot of companies which are eligible to list on main board, they have now preferred to come on SME. They have rather come on SME, be there on this platform for 2 years, and migrate onto the main board. And one factor which I think we should be very mindful, that when we migrate onto the main board, it is not necessary that company has to come up with an IPO again for migration. Migration is simply a shift from the category M, which is for the SME, from M to B category, which is a regular IPO category, onto the main board. So it's not necessary that company has to come up with further IPO. It's not necessary that company has to comply with the main board regulations. As long as it completes 2 years, as long as it has 10 crore of capital, it has to make application to the exchange. And of course, it has to have shareholder approval, 2/3 of public shareholders approval, and it can migrate onto the main board. Compliances, it was remarked in the opening statements that compliance is also one such factor, and you'll be very happy to note that a lot of compliances which involve cost and administration, that have been thoughtfully relaxed, in as much as that even the quarterly results are not required to be prepared, they are not required to be published in newspapers. What is required is only a half-yearly limited reviewed accounts, and companies have to simply email to the exchange and put up on the website. So all those costly advertisements and preparations are avoided. Even annual copies can be emailed to the exchange and shareholders. So that was broadly the norms part. Coming to the advantages, I think by and large nicely summarized by Ajay sir, but just to add to some more points, if we have to look at the advantages, I mean, we can divide probably in this four baskets. A lot of operational benefits, I'll rather than narrating, probably I'll share two, three examples because of paucity of time, and that will throw a lot of insights. We have listed one company called Ultra Cab. It is a cable manufacturing company from Rajkot. 35 crore of top line and a crore of rupees of bottom line, profit after tax. The company is into manufacturing of tailor-made cables. And after 6 months of listing, we were sitting with the promoter asking his feedback as to how it has benefited his business. It was a very simple point, but completely transforming the business model. Since the company used to manufacture the order-based cable products like lift cables, etc., they generally work on advances. They take advance and then, of course, they will make the cable and deliver the cable. Before listing, according to the promoter, they used to find it very difficult because people used to think it's a Lala company, unlisted company, whether the goods will come on time, whether it will be as per the specification, etc., etc. But after listing on BSE SME, their main hassle kind of got addressed itself, and since it's BSE listed company, so companies, the clients or customers didn't used to even negotiate on the advance part because it's a BSE listed company, so where is the question? They will probably discuss on some other point. So simple point, but completely transformed, and you will be amazed to note that a company with initial market capital of 30 crore in a year and a half, or probably less than that, the market capital of the company is now 250 crore. So every single working day, the company's market capital is increased or increasing by 1 crore of rupees. So that's the kind of support companies get, and investors, of course, they get return. Another example is Rudra TMT. They are in TMT manufacturing. You must have come across the advertisement on CNBC or other channels, Paresh Rawal's advertisement, Sariye ki guarantee or something like that. 350 crore of turnover, and all of us are aware that steel products are under huge pressure. The margins are very less, probably less than a percent on the sales value. So this promoter, what he has done is that he spent a lot of amount on brand building, and he is now giving his brand on royalty. So all those manufacturers who are not doing so great, they are using the brand Rudra, and they are selling under that brand, adhering to the quality standards of Rudra TMT. So for that promoter, listing was a means of brand building. And after listing, they have gone in the new territories of Rajasthan, beyond Gujarat basically, which were their existing territory. And according to them, the listing has helped them immensely in brand building and adding to their, you know, business model. So like that, as rightly stated, there are a lot of advantages which a business gives. There is also a paper which has been under discussion between SEBI and RBI that SME listed companies should be treated as priority sector, and there should be a differential beneficial interest regime for SME listing. Be it as may, as of now there is no such scheme. But what is important is, in almost every company after listing, the credit rating has been improved significantly, and the cost of interest is reduced significantly. Some of the companies, I can go on and taking the examples, but some of the companies have even taken the benefit of 2.5% reduction in interest post-listing. Even the margin, the collateral margin is reduced. What bank used to fund before listing, they definitely tend to fund more against the same collateral. So listing also makes bankability very easy and makes it very smooth. Tax, of course, more than me, but just to kind of round it up, Whether a company issues shares at premium, whether somebody buys at discount, whether somebody sells at premium, so all the capital transactions are subject to 20% to 30% of taxes. And the period of holding for unlisted shares since last budget, it has been equated with property. It has been announced from 1 year to 3 years. However, in case of listed shares, the long-term definition of 1 year is retained. And after listing, whether you buy at premium or sell at premium, company issuing at premium, there is no taxes either on the buyer or on the company or on the seller. So that's a big, you know, legitimate tax planning as far as listing is concerned. And there have been cases where people have, or the officers at initial level have raised queries that it's a tax saving or tax avoidance ploy, but courts have very clearly ruled that even if a company holds any property, but shares are transferred on the stock exchange and STT is paid, there is no question of any avoidance and it's legitimate tax planning. And this kind of tax planning can be for the structuring, for the M&A, for mergers, amalgamation, and also for the succession planning, because a lot of times shares are required to be transferred even between family, and it may not even fall within the definition of gift under relatives. So listing helps on those situations as well. Most important is wealth. Value creation is very nicely described, that it's a migration from tax model to wealth model. One rupee of profit, we often give this example to make entrepreneurs understand. Of course, we all know 1 rupee of profit cost 33 paisa of tax. But in stock exchange, it is always a price earning multiple. So 1 rupee of profit gives, let's say, 20 rupees of valuation. So trade-off is very simple: to pay 33 paisa and earn a value of 20 rupees. Or of course, there are sectors which are having price earning ratio of even 50, 70, 80. So that's the kind of probably message we need to share with our circles and clients, that look, gone are the days of tax planning. Have your balance sheet properly done up, and that's where companies and balance sheets can avail the optimum benefit of valuation through listing. Listed shares acts as currency. It can be given to employees as part of their compensation scheme that will save directly the cost to the company. At the same time, it will be a good value for the employee as well, both from reward as well as retention point of view. There is some small acquisition, 20 crore, 25 crore, 10 crore. Instead of taking liquidity out of the business, shares can be given if the shares are listed. Temporary funding required, no collateral. Probably you pledge your shares if they are listed and take funds against this. So if listed shares kind of becomes own currency, and that can be monetized or used as substitute of currency in several ways, whether as M&A currency or funding means, or as we discussed, optimization of employee cost. Some of the companies like UltraCab, there is another company, MD Inducto, the same company, Rudra, or even Ashapura Intimates, which was only 10 crore of net worth. And I think 2.5 years, the company's market capital is 500 crore. And at today's valuation, there are mutual funds like BlackRock Mutual Fund and a lot of other investors, institutional investors, who have invested in that script. So a lot of times people say that this is notional value, why should we pay tax, it's only on paper. So then probably we have to share these kind of examples, that at the current valuation, there have been cases where people have been, or promoters or shareholders have been able to monetize and raise funds for themselves and the company. Due diligence, probably I'll skip the slide. Process is like any other IPO, conversion from a private entity to a corporate entity, increase the authorized share capital, and of course your role as chartered accountant is very, very crucial. In fact, if somebody asks that what is the most important process which is time consuming and which is important in the overall issue, it is at your hands without any doubt, in terms of peer review of financial statements. So like for main board, the 5 years financial statements and also the interim, if the issue is opening after 6 months of the audit, then the interim period audit, the stub period audit, that has to be by a peer reviewed audit, and that has to be restated as per the format given or provided in the SEBI ICDR regulations. And of course, we need to take NOC and have the governance norms complied as per the new listing regulations or the erstwhile listing agreement. Market making, lot of times we come across platform is not liquid, there are hardly any trades. All these are lot of probably hearsay, not backed by facts. See, what is important on this platform is there's a market maker sitting out every day to give the quote and to act as counterparty. So if I have already invested in an SME script but there is no buyer, I can still sell the shares on the market because market maker is obligated to buy. On the contrary, if I want to purchase the shares and if there is no seller, market maker has an inventory of shares out of which he will sell, and I as an investor can buy the shares. So liquidity is not important. What is important is the market making, and which has been mandatorily required for at least 3 years. 5% of IPO size is the inventory of shares which market maker has to keep with them so that they can sell the shares if there are buyers, and 25% of IPO size is their maximum buying obligation. So between 5 to 25 they have to meet the buy and sell obligations. These are the lot size. So at times the lot size will come to even 1.5 lakhs because to make the trading uniform, SEBI has given the price band. So for every price band, the lot size is defined such that the minimum value is at least 1 lakh of rupees. And of course, then exchange reviews based on the changes in prices. ITP, relatively recent phenomena and practically a distant phenomena. Listing without IPO is almost stopped, if I can say so, at least with the current or the extent kind of scenario where any company with bank finance or 50 lakh of rupees of investment by any registered intermediary like merchant banker, they could have come forward and listed without IPO. Now their criteria have been equated with any company which will come out with even an IPO on this platform. So 25% of institutional investment at pre-IPO stage is what is required for a company to come and list even without IPO on this platform. And there is another condition which is under discussion in professional circles, is that no person or person acting in concert can hold more than 25% of post-IPO shareholding. So these are a couple of conditions which probably make listing on institutional trading platform a little difficult, and that's why we have not seen even a single listing after this new regulations have come. The another subset of this platform is listing with IPO, which is more commonly known as startup IPO. So there are requirement of minimum 200 allottees and minimum application size of 10 lakhs. So people are finding it a bit difficult, but of course this is an evolutionary stage, and this is more to facilitate e-commerce, technology, IT companies, and a couple of companies have recently gone abroad on markets like AIM of London, and they had raised funds there because in Indian context the valuation was linked to the price earning ratio, and these companies will never have profits in initial years. So if there is no profit after tax, where is the question of PE ratio? Then there are issue objects, that where the funds will be utilized. So this framework which is designed for conventional companies, this is probably not suited for e-commerce companies, and in that context people used to find it very difficult to meet the condition, and taking a stock from the market, SEBI has been proactive enough along with the exchanges to lay a new framework and relax these kind of conditions. However, we are still to see any listing on this platform. Crowdfunding, as rightly mentioned, it's a very simple to understand as far as the concept goes, the definition goes, but very complex to understand as far as the practical context goes. So raising of funds from a group of people or from public through some platform, let's say some website or some such source, is what is crowdfunding. Largely, so far it has been on the first model, where some music program is organized or some kind of event is organized. So how we collect funds and make some event happen, so the new age technology can be deployed and raise funds from members of public or members of that particular group. So four types of crowdfunding in theory. One is donation, where donation can be pooled to meet expenditure of some kind of program or event. Second is that a group of people pool money and fund a venture, and in reward they can take the goods or service or the output of that particular business, maybe on concessional basis or some kind of discounts as reward, because they are the people who have funded that idea or business. Equity model, SEBI discussion paper itself has raised a lot of queries, because there are risk factors, there are issues in terms of how the investors will get exit, there are issues in terms of how foreign investments will take place. So I think it's more at very, very conceptualization stage, that if equity has to be issued against crowdfunding, then SEBI, RBI and probably the professional institutions and exchanges have to put their thoughts together, and we'll see how this evolves. Lending again is like how lending takes place. Similarly, a group of people can lend to a business through crowdfunding platform. So yes, it has started somewhere. There are websites in India, like example which has been given even in the opening remark, Keto. Like that, there have been sites, you know, Fund Dreams India or catapult.com. But largely they have been donation based, and we are yet to see a structured crowdfunding platform which can actually fund businesses. That's probably, that's not there as of now. So probably I'll circulate the presentation, and all I can share in the form of a concluding remark is that there's a great opportunity which has been provided by SEBI and exchange in terms of giving a platform to emerging business. There is no need to wait for the businesses to achieve a particular scale and size in terms of turnover or in terms of profits. Any company with, let's say, 3 crore of capital and net worth can come up, or even a new company can come forward with a net worth or capital of 5 crore and raise funds. And size is not really important. What is important is business. And we have examples of even companies with 600 crore of turnover which have come forward and tapped or are in the process of tapping SME capital markets. And of course, 2 years is a sufficient time before which they can migrate, they can beef up their internal systems, they can prepare themselves for the larger platform with the larger requirement. And after 2 years, once they are ready, it's an option which they can exercise, not necessarily that they have to migrate necessarily after 2 years. So they can exercise their option anytime. Once they exercise, market making and lot size restrictions are not applicable, because there is no such concept on the main board. If they choose to continue, definitely these conditions will continue to apply. And of course, in the process, they can raise funds. Rest all funding platforms in terms of preferential allotment, in terms of rights issue, in terms of making share sale in the market, those options are definitely available. And there have been examples of a lot of SME companies which have done preferential allotment or rights issue, or even there are some companies which are thinking of raising funds through further, you know, FPO, further public offer while being on SME. So rest all platform is same as for any main board script, so they can raise funds and become, you know, a leading company in their sector. So with this, I think this is what I thought I'll share with you. Thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity.
Sir, thank you for taking us to the journey of wealth creation. And as London speaker said, we shall be putting up the presentation made by him in our website of the society. Maybe in a day or two, one can take it from the society, download the same. Sir, if I use in a lighter way that I met you very late, I wish I should have met both of you 3 years back, and I should have been one of the biggest beneficiaries of wealth creation. Nevertheless, sir, I think we have about 5 minutes for 2 to 3 questions. So, should anybody would like to have, please.
Companies, even there have been software companies which have listed on SME. It may not be fully appropriate to say that software companies cannot, but particularly those companies which do not meet the criteria, yes, they cannot come on the SME. But sir, criteria are, are set at very minimum threshold. So even if there, let's say there are no profits, but the net worth or the capital of the company is 5 crore. Still, I think the company can come and list on SME. So while they can come up and list on SME, but yes, AIM and startup IPO or our platform of India may not be comparable. And that's where SEBI is in the process of making it very, very smooth and facilitative. There are some initial hiccups, but I'm sure the way it has been conceptualized and SEBI has been kind of able to lay a framework which is more relaxed than what the conventionally we have been seeing. That shows probably the market regulator wants to have a facilitative regime, and I'm sure that platform will also flourish like SME. Of course, there are changes which may be required, and they are in discussion stage. You would like to add, sir?
In BSC SME, we have got companies from 18 different sectors. Even 4 or 5 IT companies are also there. It has got listed. Now, as far as I think you are talking about that, we will not be able to meet the criteria of 3 crores, 3 crores and 3 crores, right? No, but all these companies have met those criteria. So somehow sometimes we are unable to understand our own balance sheet. So my request is that even if there is some sort of, suspicion in your mind that I am not qualifying those criteria that has been mentioned on the SME platform, request you to please take your balance sheet or bring your balance sheet to us or to the merchant banker so that they can give you the different perspective of reading the balance sheet and PL account and help you in bringing your company on the SME platform.
For companies listed on SME platform, is there any stipulation as to the minimum spread or let's say what we understand as a tick size between the buying and selling price?
See, we have we have defined a spread between the buy and sell, that what should be the maximum spread between the buy and sell at different price point. So that price point we have mentioned on that circular, we have issued the circular. Normally any company having the price up to 20 rupees or 20 rupees, we are saying that, or 30 rupees, we say that the maximum spread should be 8%. Then 30 to 56%, and 50 to 100, 5%, and 100 and above somewhere 4%. So like that we have defined that what should be the spread between buy and sell, that is the maximum spread that a market maker can keep. At the same time, we have also specified that 75% of the market hours, the market maker has to provide two-way quotes. Okay, so that sufficient liquidity should be there to give an entry and exit to the investors.
Hi, I'm Dinesh Verma, and my question is to Mahavir. It's with regard to the crowdfunding, which we have discussed in brief. Probably we don't have any laws as of today with regard to crowdfunding, number one. And number two, the websites which we saw briefly on the slides, because we have restrictions on pooling of investments and lending, RBI governs and NBFC issues are already there. How these companies are operating or complying with these laws?
Sir, you are very right in terms of there is no regulations, and probably that's what all of us are waiting for, some regulation. A discussion paper was released somewhere, I think, in June 2014, but after that, discussion paper raised more issues than giving the solutions. But in terms of these websites, they are more of a donation-based websites. So if an event is there, they will pool funds and organize the event. So there is no equity or no instrument which is being issued. There is no commercial intent to it. So probably those regulations what we are discussing, they are not applicable, as this is not a business venture. It's more of you know, social cause kind of projects which are being funded.
Equity and the debt thing as of in the current scenario as of today is not applicable. It's more of an academic discussion which we have.
Correct.
Because otherwise they can't do it.
They can't do, and in fact there are a lot of questions, and some of questions which have been thrown on us in terms of this paper is that how the private placement rules will apply, how the Companies Act rules will apply. So what we are seeing as of now is no equity, it's purely donation, and these questions remain, and there will be a complete change required in terms of the Companies Act, in terms of Section 42 of the Companies Act, in terms of FEMA, if there is overseas investment which is kind of explored through crowdfunding. So as of now, that is more of discussion paper or discussion points rather than the actual practice. What we are seeing is only social projects which are getting funded out of donations.
No, actually in a different way, the crowdfunding which is being operated today is by the angel investors. They are nothing but a crowdfunding. Well, it's like it's a group of people who are there in this auditorium today. If we decide to form a group, and this is the, I think that is nothing but another form of crowdfunding. Does SEBI allow that?
Sir, angel funding is not crowdfunding. Angel funding is could be through a network or without network. Angel funding definitely means like I have an idea and I do not have fund. So some angel comes and fund my idea. So that's how the name has evolved.
No, I'm saying
but
group,
how it,
the group, where the
yeah,
group of
how it happens, how it happens is that even if it's in small amounts and by a group, it has to be in accordance with those maximum limit of investors, and it is through a private placement.
That's okay. I understand that. That means
getting later now because same person asking so many questions. I think we are.
Yeah, please.
May I request all others who want to have questions later on after the whole party is over here, and I'm sure learned speaker would be happy to answer. I would just say that nevertheless, the Honorable Managing Director of BAC was to join us, but because he has to travel, which we appreciate, he couldn't make it up. We are sure Ajay sir will definitely give us the benefit of the Honorable Managing Director in some other meeting on the BAC. May I request Samir Kapadia to complete the formality by proposing well-deserved vote.
A very good evening to all of you. I have been given the pleasant task of proposing a vote of thanks to the dignitaries on the dais. To begin with, I was interacting with Preeti just when this meeting started, that when you consider this topic and the galaxy of speakers and the people that we have today, it is very unique in many ways. If you look at the topic, it says crowdfunding, it says newcomers, IPOs and SMEs. Ajay ji and Neeraj both pointed out that BSE has been in existence for 140 years. I would be maybe a little bit forthright, maybe a little bit bold to say it was a startup on its own when it came up as an exchange in India. It was a newcomer when it came up as an exchange in India. Bcas also in that regard was one of the first and the premier organizations as far as CAs was concerned. It was the first startup. It started with a small crowd, and it's a big crowd today. It's no longer an SME. It's migrated to the main board. Ajay ji also started with something very small, a small idea in his head, a small idea in his heart, and it has grown to be this platform as we know it. Mahavir, I can just tell you that when we were studying together in our GLC batch, what he learned there and how he has applied it, he started as a newcomer and he has grown big along with this platform, and I don't need to say where he stands today. I'm sure all of us will take this inspiration and move in the same light and will move with the same speed, and God willing, we'll all be having the same kind of market cap that Mahavir was talking about just a few minutes ago. Coming to the pleasant task, first and foremost, I would like to thank the BSC, mainly Ajay ji, for making this event happen, for putting in all the efforts and ensuring this superb venue. Not to mention that all the background work that went into preparation for this event. Apart from that, Ajay ji also shared his ideas. What he shared with us is that listing, the one big takeaway that I can take away from this talk is that listing is not only raising funds, it is unlocking of value, it is value creation, it is wealth creation, it brings in a lot of discipline in the promoters, it brings about a lot of credibility, and most important takeaway, the virtues of good investment and virtues of good promoting. Don't be too greedy. Too much of everything can be very bad. I think that is one big takeaway that everybody should realize. I think the old idiom was that greed is good. I don't think so. Mahavir also on his own took us through the plethora of the regulatory aspects. He was very crisp, he was very clear, and he has given it in a very, very simple language. I'm sure you'll agree that both these speakers have spent a lot of time on this area, and they have been kind enough and generous enough to share their valuable experience, which nobody does. For this, I would request all of you to carry out this vote of thanks with a very round and loud applause. Thank you. Thank you. I would now request the Vice President.
I request you to also give a very large applause for our keynote address, Mr. Neeraj.
Yeah, he is not there. He is already left, but I would propose a vote of thanks for Mr. Neeraj also. And with this, we would conclude the session. Thank you.